The new word was cuck for a little while, right? Was that making
cuck? Kinda.
Was it making its rounds in your under seat?
It's not fun to. It's fun to say, but it's not something you can use it regularly. Mm-hmm. While retarded, people were saying at comedy clubs very regularly all of a sudden. And yeah, it's because Rick and Morty and people are saying more on certain podcasts and stuff like that. And some people don't find it offensive. So yeah, I heard it at work today.
Yeah.
But I said it. Mm-hmm. But I didn't want to retard.
That's how you heard it, bro.
I didn't want to retard the funding process for a client.
Right.
So I said it that way. Well, I don't want to retard this process. And nobody batted an eye because it seemed so, and also didn't say retarded. I said, I don't want to retard this process.
Right. I see what you're doing. You're slipping it in regular, like versions
the way
of the
it
word.
Should be.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. And every once in a while.
Every
this project is retarded because you know it's taking, it's being.
Here, this is what I done. I don't like saying the word retarded because I had a coworker that had a disability and I heard somebody else say it and I saw this guy's face just break down.
Okay.
Not break down, but you could tell it hurt him. Mm. And this guy was, he had a disability. He'd been in the Special Olympics twice. He has a medal for Canada. But like just hearing somebody say retarded, like, oh, that's retarded. You could tell it broke, like it just hurt him.
Because he heard it so many times growing up.
So I try never to say it. But then I was at a popular, a formal dinner where an uncle called Donald Trump, an uncle who has somebody in the family, you know, with a mental disability. He's like, Donald Trump is mentally retarded. And I just thought it was the funniest thing I heard in such a long time where I just burst out laughing while everybody else was still talking about politics. I just thought it was the funniest thing. But now I'm just trying to make sure I don't accidentally say it because I don't want to have it in my vocabulary. That's all.
Right.
Because I will say it inappropriately when I'm excited and then I'll hurt somebody.
Yeah, that's true.
That's all I really clear.
Yeah, you don't want it. You don't want it in the chamber.
Yeah, I have very offensive jokes that I have worked on that make sure that I hurt your feeling while you find the humor in what I'm saying.
Right. Yeah.
That's my tenet. That's what I aim to do.
Right.
I don't want to like frivolously hurt somebody while like
right
just
without
being careless.
A joke. Yeah.
Yeah. I don't even believe in that. I feel like if you're gonna tell an offensive joke, great, tell your offensive joke. If it's 9 out of 10 offensive, then it better be 10 out of 10 funny.
Right.
But if it's 7 out of 10 funny and 9 out of 10 offensive, then you're an asshole.
That's when someone writes a blog a blog post.
Well, people are going to write a blog regardless, man. But just as a comic, me judging other comics, if it's funnier than the offensiveness, I will applaud.
Right.
No matter almost what you talk about. So... yeah, that's why we like Bill Burr.
Real quick, you said that you had finished watching both of Dave Chappelle.
Yeah, I did.
You'd let it digest for a little bit.
I saw them both at least 3 times.
Yeah, me too.
And I liked them. I didn't love them.
Yep.
And maybe that's because maybe in a year I'll love him or something.
I don't think so.
I don't think so either.
I think it's slightly dated.
Yeah.
I think in the realm of all of the other ones that we really love, like the Louie CKs, the Bill Burrs.
Right. Or the earlier, For What It's Worth, you know?
Yeah.
Both of them. The one he did in Washington and the one he did in San Francisco.
Yeah.
They're great specials.
Yeah. It might be because of dated material, but it does feel like his stuff is like offset from time. Time had moved a little bit.
Yeah.
And then Dave Chappelle is whatever. But you maybe think, his new stuff will
you
be
think
great.
You would have liked if he was skinnier? Does that play anything? The visual change from early Dave to now Dave?
No, I'm down.
You're
down
okay?
With it.
All right,
yeah,
just one. Totally, I liked him better when he was skinny.
Skinny?
I thought he was funnier. He just looked funny.
You're the same. That's the same thing. The complaints were like, hey, man, don't lose any weight because you're not going to get a certain roles. Or
I'm just saying. I'm just saying what it looked like.
Yeah.
That's all I'm saying. All
right, fair enough.
And I'm just trying to figure out why this didn't hit me anywhere near the previous ones that hit me. There are parts of both of them that are decent,
right.
Especially the second one.
Yeah.
But overall, I was like, could have been one special. But you know what? $30 million. Okay.
Yeah. Do it. Do it up.
Do it up.
Did you watch... did you watch Louis C.K.'s? Because the special got released on Netflix. So did you end up watching it again?
That's the one we saw in person, right? I saw the first 10 minutes and I was like, yeah, I've seen this. I was surprised by how perfectly timed it was exactly.
Yes.
Like his stutters were the same. And I was like, oh, that's very impressive.
Yes.
But I didn't watch it again. But I hear, I have friends that watched it and they loved it. So.
Right. he had to do it differently because, like, yeah. you know what? He baits there's a joke in there where he's like, why is the year 2000 and yes. and whatever, right? Yeah. 2017. And then when we had watched it, mm-hmm. someone had yelled out Jesus.
Right.
Right. So he was able to play, like, so he takes that and he's like, Jesus, and he yells it out.
Yeah.
That's funny. Mm-hmm. The thing is that during the recording, someone yelled out Christ.
Right.
So he had to roll with that.
Whoa.
That was kind of interesting.
Well, you
it's not big. It's not a big adjustment, but it was still funny.
It's funny, man.
Yeah.
Funny, man.
He's great.
Pound for pound for me, funniest guy working right now. For me, I feel like he's better than Bill Burr right now. Bill Burr's special. If you look, just look at specials out in the last bit.
Then, yeah, Louie CK.
Yeah, I think it's Louie.
Yeah.
I'm probably missing a bunch. There's new specials every day by, you know, less known comics. But, like, I think, yeah, as far as...
Can you do me a favor?
Of course.
And watch Matt Brunner. Brunner? Matt Brunner.
Okay.
His special.
I'll watch it.
It's freaking hilarious,
I'll watch
man.
It this weekend.
It's so damn good.
It's a damn good.
It's, you get a... what's the guy, Brian Regan? You get a Brian Regan vibe,
mm-hmm.
but he's not squeaky clean.
Okay,
it's like that. Like it's like, go ahead.
I got an offer to do a corporate gig.
Yeah,
and they asked me to be squeaky clean to the point of they're like, yeah, if you're gonna say, you know, he did, you say he or she did. I was like, what? Yeah, he's like, if you're telling a story, just try to make it both genders. And I went like, excuse me? Like, I'm not doing this for $50. I did want to, but there was just too much.
Oh, at that point, you can't, you're going to be spending your entire mental space.
Is going to be
clogged with you being able to like say both genders throughout the way.
And I'm not doing stand-up for money. I'm just trying to get good at stand-up.
Yep.
So I'm like, I don't want to... Then I asked her a few other questions about like what I can't say. I gave her some of my worst examples of jokes. I'm like... Can I talk about Alzheimer's patients? She's like, definitely not. And I was like, Susan, I don't know if this is going to work. She was like, well, we don't know any magician. Comics. And yeah. I was like, maybe get a magician. She laughed and then we had to part right there.
Right.
But one of my friends who does these kind of, he has actually a very good squeaky clean corporate gigs that he does.
Mm.
He wasn't available. So he gave her my contact information.
I see.
And then I realized that I'm no good for corporate gigs. I'll eventually do it, but it was just, this was for a tech company and they were just way too progressive.
Right.
In terms of just making sure all the bases were covered. Where I'm like, I don't know if that's funny. Yeah, I'm like, I don't know if that's funny.
Yeah.
I mean, just me talking then, being very appropriate.
I don't like squeaky. First of all, at a corporate event,
right?
You shouldn't be having fun.
Yeah. There shouldn't be a stand up on stage.
Nope. Nope.
There shouldn't be one.
It shouldn't be. You go over there, you crack a couple like, you know, your innocuous jokes.
Yeah.
You put out your fake laugh that you normally do when you're at work.
Right.
That's funny. You do one of those things.
Yeah.
Right? You shake some hands, you schmooze if you want to schmooze, and then you pack your shit up and you go home.
Yeah.
There's no space for you to like, oh, I'm going to unwind and really show my sense of humor over here.
Right.
Get out of here,
no,
man.
Get out of here.
It's at work.
Here's the thing. At one point, the only way to make money doing stand-up was being squeaky clean.
Mm.
There was no other way because the trajectory was you do some clubs, you do bigger clubs, you get known, you end up on Letterman or one of those shows and do your squeaky clean act there.
Yeah.
And then you might get a sitcom out of
it.
And that was the end of the tunnel.
Yeah.
Sitcom money.
Yes.
That was what everybody was doing.
Because after Seinfeld, people were like, God dang.
Before Seinfeld too.
Who is the big example?
Everybody. I mean... You pick a sitcom.
Oh, okay.
It
was a stand-up had done it. Yeah. Okay, fair enough.
So, like, even let's just say Full House, like, with Bob Saget and Dave Coulier, they were trying to get them. They were stand-ups.
Yeah, but Bob Saget is not clean.
Oh, I know. He didn't make his money doing stand-up, though.
Bob Saget has got to be one of the most filthiest comics.
Unnecessarily so. He talks about, like...
He
talks about things I don't want to even say into this mic, and I do stand-up. I'm like, that's gross.
The most... Oh my God. And the thing is that I had no idea.
Oh, you Googled it. You saw some.
I had no idea about him. So, you know, you grew up, you watch your Full House.
Yeah.
You were happy.
Yep.
Right? And then
everybody
day,
hugs three times an episode.
And then one day, one of my university friends, he's like, have you heard the story, The Aristocrats?
Yes. I've seen the documentary on that, actually.
He's like, why don't you listen to this? I did. Wow.
Right.
I can't, at your own peril,
mm-hmm.
go ahead and Google The Aristocrats by Bob Saget.
By Bob Saget. Here's the thing. That joke has many, many, many endless variations.
Yep.
And they're all disgusting because every comic adds like a super disgusting thing to it.
Yeah. But I believe Bob Saget.
I believe you. I've heard him on a podcast and I couldn't, like, he was talking about shoving things in places and so many things, like what he would do for money or what he would do to other people.
It's like his own mom.
It was messed up.
What's funny though, when you listen to him with like someone who's generally kind of more cleaner, like Chris Hardwick,
right?
It is funny. By the way, they used to be drinking buddies. They used to get drunk and drive.
I know what you meant, dude. You didn't have to move your hands.
It's crazy.
It's crazy.
Crazy. I can't believe he's still around.
Bob Saget?
Yeah.
Why wouldn't he be?
I don't know. You feel like you were that self-destructive.
He's not.
Back then, I think he was.
Was he?
Yeah.
How?
Drinking and driving.
Well, okay. Yeah, you're right. Yeah, you're right. That is pretty self-destructive. I was like, because in my head, I'm like, is he doing other drugs? Is he doing heroin? I'm like, no, he's drinking and driving. And that's all you need to know. That's how you die.
Oh, man.
I apologize.
No, it's nothing.
Little girl turned out well for the most part.
Which one?
No, you know what? None of them did.
The Olsen?
I forgot that the girl from the X-Men, mm-hmm. one of their sisters, that's not one of them. Or is it? That's their sister.
It's their sister.
Yeah. It's an Olsen sister, but not one of the twins.
Not one of the twins.
Right.
Yes,
okay.
Yes.
Because those twins aren't doing anything, from what I understand.
No, I think they're fashion designers and they have like a...
Yeah,
I think
so they're doing like nothing with their lives. They've made up what they're doing.
Yeah.
I'm sure they're actually... Who knows? I'm perfectly content saying they're doing jack all.
Fair enough.
But that's why you have.
As far as I'm concerned, the best Olsen sibling,
yeah.
is the ones that are doing the movies currently. Like the witch. She's awesome.
She's great.
Yeah.
Yeah.
She wasn't in X-Men. Avengers.
Avengers. Yes, she was the mind controller and stuff.
The witch.
Some people from sitcoms make it.
Yeah.
And other people just don't. Like just don't.
Ray Romano.
What do you mean, made it or didn't?
Well, he was in a sitcom. And then after that, well, he does a lot of voice acting.
Here, this is what I'll tell you about Ray Romano. Probably has about $400 million in the bank from Everybody Loves Raymond. He created it, right?
Yeah.
No exaggeration.
Yeah, yeah.
Probably to date, around $400 to $500 million.
Right.
And it's syndicated and it just keeps going and going.
Yeah.
And then in every Ice Age movie, he's the walrus or whatever, the woolly mammoth.
Right.
And you know, every time he opens his mouth there, he's getting paid at least $5 million.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, he's good. I think Ray's fine. Mm-hmm. I would say like a top of the shelf, worst case scenario would be like Screech from Saved by the Bell.
Yeah.
Started doing porn.
Yep.
And then started doing like celebrity rehab where he's just getting into fights with people. Yeah, that's no bueno.
That's what happened.
No good.
And yeah. Okay, continue. I want to. I'm looking for the net worth of Ray Romano.
Just ask your phone.
I can't do it. I don't. My phone doesn't listen to me.
It's all right. Why don't you talk while I ask it? Because it'll be easy.
I feel. What's his name? Seinfeld is still going to be number one.
What is Ray Romano's net worth?
According to Wikipedia, Raymond Albert Ray Romano is an American stand-up comedian, actor, and.
This bitch is giving me. Sorry, its whole life history. When I ask her a straightforward question, $120 million is what he made in 2012. So that was that year. I think that was his peak, though.
Okay. Fair
so
enough.
With that said, he's set. He doesn't need
no. He's
and
fine.
You know what? He doesn't have the personality where he's like doing cocaine off of like hookers or something.
No, he seems like he's a very well-adjusted dude.
He plays golf. He has, I think, 3 kids that look a lot like him, unfortunately. He's got a big house and a wife. I saw a documentary. He's well-respected.
Yeah.
He also
people,
does a
people
lot of
love him. Like, so, you know what?
Yeah.
I never thought that comedians respected Seinfeld. Seinfeld. Mm. I never thought it did. I never thought they respected Ray Romano. I thought they would just be like, oh, he's, you know, or whatever. But like, when other comedians talk, no matter how blue their material is or how like dirty their material is or how clean it is.
Yeah.
When they talk about Seinfeld, they're like the king.
Yeah.
Right? Or when they talk about Ray Romano, they say like one of the best writers.
Definitely.
Like one of the best joke writers.
That is a something that I, just like yourself, I didn't realize. Mm-hmm. But now since I pay attention to how people write, especially like a guy like Louis or Patton Oswalt.
Yeah.
Yeah. Ray Romano and Jerry Seinfeld are amazing joke writers.
Yeah.
It's not like they're great storytellers necessarily. Mm-hmm. You know, you have Chris D'Elia who can like, he can make anything funny.
Hello, Dad.
Right.
Hello, Dad.
Exact. Great example. He can make anything hilarious. And that's something all comics can kind of do, but like to craft a joke and then move it around to make it perfect and tight.
Yeah,
man. Some people have a gift. Like you can tell that, yeah, this is an artist. Yeah, they're a jester, mm-hmm. but they're also an artist.
Yeah.
Well, other people's are very much no shit. Nope. I don't have any issues with Kevin Hart. I've seen him live. I paid $120 to do so. And I don't regret spending that kind of money.
Yeah.
With that said, he's super, and some of those jokes aren't extremely funny, but you will laugh your ass off.
Right.
So you can't take anything away from the man. But when you like, if you watch Ray Romano live at Carnegie Hall, you'll be like, oh, these are some very well-written jokes.
Yeah.
These are some jokes here. Sorry, I don't want to talk about comedy in terms of like, this is some amazing thing,
mm-hmm.
because it is, but it's also a dude just telling jokes.
Telling jokes.
You know, so.
Still, it's pretty awesome.
Yeah, my mom can appreciate it.
Loves that show.
Which one? Everybody Loves Raymond?
Yeah.
Great show, man.
That has to be one of the shows where my mom will watch an episode, even she's done it like four times, she'll watch it again.
Nice. What show is that for you? I'll get mine out of the way. It's Scrubs.
Really? Still? I used to watch it on Justin TV. I used to watch Justin Scrubs on TV. Justin TV.
Do people even know about Justin TV? I used to watch everything on Justin TV. Yeah, I used to watch Star Trek. Justin TV would just have like channels dedicated to a show and just be on. That show is just cycling from first season to 12th season and back again.
There's no pause. There's no start from the beginning. You just watch whatever is currently on.
Yeah. There's one like Tide to Go commercial at the very beginning and that's it.
Yeah.
It was great.
Great.
I used to come home, get my food, like just put on one of these channels and eat. Now we have Netflix.
Yeah.
The way it started was there was a dude named Justin Chan. I want to say Justin, Asian dude.
Yeah.
Of some sort. And he started a channel so people can watch him. And he would have a camera on his hat, on his shoulder.
Yeah.
And it'd be Justin.tv.
Yeah.
And he's like, I'll allow people to do this for themselves. And everybody else is just pirating porn or TV shows and stuff like that. And every now and then, like when it'd be a live UFC, I used to go to Justin.tv and there'd be a stream for it.
Right.
I don't even know if that thing exists anymore.
I think it eventually morphed into Twitch.tv.
Twitch I like. I've seen a lot of Halo and StarCraft.
StarCraft on that
on
one.
Twitch.
Yeah. Okay, so yours is Scrubs.
Scrubs is mine. Yeah.
Scrubs is mine.
I've seen the season start to finish at least 4 or 5 times. Mm. Friends I've seen at least 2 to 3 times. That's because of a marriage. And we're watching Gilmore Girls right now.
Okay. Friends was mine for a long period of time. I think Friends was mine.
A lot of people's.
But I don't know what I would watch right now. I'm trying to figure out what I would watch right now just to feel good. Mm. Like you get a strong dose of nostalgia.
I know.
I've been itching to go rewatch all of Naruto again.
Jeez, man, that's such a project. That's like 400 million episodes. You'd be a different person by the time you start and finish it.
Yeah, man, it went for so long. But it's, you know what? The thing is that because it lasted so long,
mm-hmm.
there's so many aspects of my life that happened during the time that I watched it that I can tie into it.
Right.
So I remember when I first started getting into anime, that was one of the ones that you'd watch.
Yeah.
And then you watch it for a while, and then sometimes you might stop watching it. I went to Mauritius and I watched it with my cousin. And there's all those memories of like hanging out in his, you know, his small room and like these, we had like shisha here and then everything's closed by 9 o'clock in Mauritius.
Yeah.
So if you want to have food, you had to make it. And so at like 1 o'clock in the morning, we're like peeling potatoes so we can cut them up and fry them for fries.
Nice.
That sounds
wonderful, actually.
It really was amazing.
Yeah.
So there's that. And then when I came back throughout university, I was watching it. And then,
it's just like music where you like, sometimes a song just takes over a summer or a relationship or something like that. And it's similar to a show, it's all those memories where you watch that show and just all comes back to you.
Do you have a song that when you listen to, you think about another girl?
No, that's my fucking song. Sorry, no offense. I didn't mean to curse like that, but no girl gets to just take my song. That's how it's her song now. Screw you.
Really?
Yeah. I know exactly the feeling. I've had that feeling.
Yeah.
And then I'll just listen to that song. Maybe not immediately, not mm-hmm. that month, but the next month. Right. I make sure that
you cycle that bitch out.
Yeah, basically is what I do, because you can't own an important song to me, like something I really like. You don't own Queen, like
right,
or whatever it is. Mm-hmm. So yeah, no, it's just like the dog attack or whatever the other things are that, you know, you get an accident, you get back into your car and you drive. You don't let the road control you anymore. So.
Interesting.
So yeah, you have that. You've lost some good songs.
Maybe one or two, but yeah. They're dated and they're not that super popular. Mm. So
what's one of those songs? He's thinking. He's crying. No.
Bubbly.
Okay.
By Colby Kayet. Am I saying that right?
Colby Calais.
There we go.
Yeah.
That one.
You're French. and that's how it's supposed to be pronounced.
There you go.
Oh, I didn't know that song. Mm. Shit. All right. Well, you can let that one go.
I don't feel any.
Yeah. It's not like We Will Rock You. Also, that's not going to remind you of a girl, right? Oh, of our jam. When you
well, it could
hang
be.
Out. Could be. We used right? to hang out in the park.
Getting ready to rock her world?
Yeah, I guess so. I don't know nothing about that. I really don't know anything about getting physical with a girl pre-marriage at all. Not even hand-holding. So maybe that's why it wasn't... You can like a girl, but like there's nothing attached to it.
Okay, so I think I do this to myself, though.
Okay.
Well, what happened is that, like, you know, let's say you're kind of talking to a girl for a little bit, right?
Right.
And you're going to go to the movies. Mm-hmm. So you're going to meet her there.
Yeah.
On your way there, or on my way there, you go and find that one song. Mm. And basically what I'm doing is I'm purposefully programming this song with that
right.
person.
I see.
I do that.
Yeah.
I do that for
you're
seasons
right.
too.
Everybody, that you're right.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the problem.
That is the problem.
Because parts of the song, you're like, yeah, you're like a swan, you know, or whatever. I'm sorry, I stand corrected. A girl did ruin a movie for me. I went to watch Wreck-It Ralph. I know, it's not, you know, but now I can't watch that movie because it reminds me of her. Mm-hmm. Because right before the movie started, during the trailers, her and I were talking and I made a joke. And then she turned over and she's like, we're going to be such funny parents. And then the movie started. And the whole time this movie's on, it's like... We're going to be such funny parents. We're going to be such funny parents in my head. And it just kept coming up like a bad mushroom trip where it's just like.
By the time it's done, you got like PTSD. You got like this. Like,
hey, parents. So yeah, and I haven't seen Wreck-It Ralph since, and I don't want to. I don't know why. Mm. And I'm fine with not watching it. But like, she somehow hijacked that movie real quick. Like sneaky, like it's even not something I did.
Right.
Like I associated this with this.
Right.
It's like, you know, you're listening to a song and a bad car accident happens. And every time the song comes up, you're just bracing yourself. Yep. So that's what kind of happened to me with this friggin' movie. Great girl, by the way. It's just,
for sure.
She did the wrong things at the wrong time. And our relationship deteriorated because of me. Mm-hmm. But because she didn't realize what she was doing, absolutely the wrong thing. At the wrong time for me, uh-huh. But she was actually normal.
Right. It was just hitting you. You weren't ready. This is not something
exactly.
that.
Exactly. Yeah, she's like, hey, you want to come meet my parents? Just nothing was hitting properly.
Oh my God.
It was like 2 weeks in. But I understood later.
Wait,
you've
done it too? Because I remember telling you that I was going to go meet someone. This was like a few years ago.
Yeah.
And you're like, are you sure?
Are you sure?
Dude, was it during. Never mind. We don't really need to know the timeline. But.
Yeah.
Was I sure? I was sure then. Then 2 days after, I was not sure after that.
And then did you go see the parents?
Yeah. I had already gone.
Oh, I see.
You know, one of the things that made me question really. Mm-hmm. So this was after Muslim Fest.
Yeah.
We were walking back to, and she was there too. So it was me, you, and her, and maybe some other friends. Mm-hmm. we're walking back to my car, and you said, oh, sister, where did you park?
Yeah.
Right? And she turned around and she said, excuse me, I have a name.
Mm.
And you, true to your normal self, you just like shrugged it off and you kept on going, right? In my head, I'm like, how dare you? talk to my friend that way. He said sister out of a form of respect.
Hey, man.
How did you not, how did you not pick that up?
I'm going to let you deal with your girlfriend in terms of like, is this a good girl? Is she going to get mad if somebody calls her sister? And I call people sister so they know that I'm not a weird dude.
Yep.
Sometimes if I meet a really attractive girl and she's Muslim, mm-hmm. I'll make a point to call her sister.
Right.
And like all of a sudden, all of our conversations are so much better after that.
Really?
Yeah, because sometimes girls have a guard up.
Yeah, they're guard up.
And
yeah.
As they should, especially pretty ones, because guys are weird, dude.
Well, guys are guys.
Guys are assholes a lot of times.
Very true.
So I like to call them sister. And then one good-looking girl, she was like, really? I'm like, yep. She's like, all right, good. It was so good. Where she's like, really? You can call me sister. I'm like, yep. She's like, all right, I see where you want to stand. Cool. And I was like,
okay.
You
do this more often now that you're married, of course.
No, man.
What? Even when you were not married? Weren't you looking for like a prospect?
No, I just like to be...
Or you like to make it harder. You call her sister and then I'm going to make you wife.
So. Right. I'm going to make you want me. She's like, oh, I'll make you husband. No, I just know that sometimes certain types of girls have been treated badly by men.
For sure.
And you can tell how much of a... You ask a question, you get a super short answer.
Right.
But once they trust you a little bit, just like anybody, they're going to have a conversation with you. And just making sure they understand your intentions
right.
makes all the difference.
Right.
It's just that simple.
Okay, but I don't feel like... First of all, I never thought of it. I say sister a lot,
right?
But obviously I say brother a lot too. So that seems to be the thing where any of my friends want to impersonate me, mm-hmm. the first word that out of their mouth will be like brother.
Yep.
It's not like
yeah, I've done it. I've had like, oh, this is what Yasin would say. I'm like, yeah, that's what Yasin would say.
So doing it for girls makes sense to me because that's just the way how my brain works.
Right.
So I'd never thought of it as like a disarming thing.
Oh, could you still go out with a girl after you called her sister? That's why, which I don't.
Well, but I'm just wondering what's your, okay, look, let me put it to you this way.
Yeah.
If you did see
right.
a girl
yeah.
that you were interested in.
Okay.
But you hadn't met her yet.
Right.
But like, you know, it's a group mm-hmm. thing and then whatnot. And then you can start talking to that particular person, hypothetically speaking.
Right.
Would you still go with a disarming sister and then work
no.
your way backwards?
No. Mm-hmm. I think if I say sister, I've like put a certain light on me that you just can't take off. I normally say sister when I've done something that I feel like might have confused her. Like, I got two coffees. Do you want a coffee? And now she thinks I'm trying to get her a coffee.
Right.
Or I'm like, no, sister, do you want a coffee? She's like, yeah, brother.
Okay. All right,
so yeah, I would never, if I'm interested in a girl, I'm mm-hmm. not going to call her sister.
Right, okay.
And my personality is such that I will end up friend zoning myself eventually. So I'm not going to make it, you know.
You open up with the opening salvo of...
I'm not a flirter, man. I don't have a charming voice or a height or a nice, you know, all your pants and stuff. Literally, like all your pants is what I hold against you that you have more than two. But like, yeah, so for me, it's just, you know, humor. That's really about it. So.
I mean, I'm pretty sure that's the biggest charmer.
Sometimes, yeah.
Humor.
It's, yeah, oddly enough. Who knew?
I don't think so. Dude, every time you watch like, what is it? Like The Fifth Wheel or something. What do you look in a man or for a man or whatever it is?
Mm-hmm.
The first thing that comes out of their mouth. It makes me laugh.
It's not true though, right?
Sense of humor.
Yeah, but that it's not like a fat guy who's bald and has like his belly.
No, no, we all know what she's saying. But right. like, because she doesn't want to come across as shallow and be like, I want him straight up hot and he needs to make me laugh. Yeah. They will start with that one.
What she's trying to say, and just like guys, is just like, as long as I'm attracted to him and he makes decent money, then humor, you know? Because she can't start off by like, you know, I like a guy that's good looking. Yeah. That's really what I look for. Or right. like a guy who has a nice car. Right. That's really what I look for. But like, those things being said, humor.
Yeah.
What else is there though? I like a guy who's angry? Like, no. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I don't know what the options really are. I want a guy who's really efficient. No, like, I'd be nice, but if he doesn't, like, you want to have a good time with whoever you are.
For
guys
sure.
and girls.
Let me ask you this then.
Of course.
Is it important
mm-hmm.
for your wife to be able to make you laugh too?
No. But it's very important for your wife and you to be able to have laughs together.
Mm.
Regardless of what she's saying. Because I haven't met too many women.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I have a lot of guy friends, and they make me crack up. Right. I've met only two girls, and I'm like, whoa, you're legitimately
right.
funny.
Mm-hmm.
But you just want to share the same, similar sense of humor with your wife
right.
and just laugh and enjoy the similar things in life.
Fair enough.
If my wife was always making me crack up, that'd be great too. But like, I don't know. I feel like, it's not like a thing. I feel like this girl thinks she's funny. She's funny. She did stand up, whatever. But no, I'm kidding. But it is important for your wife and you to have the same sense of humor. And right. if a girl doesn't have the same sense of humor as I do, yeah. then she's not attractive to me anymore.
Yeah, it's very true.
Yeah.
Nothing's more awkward than you making a joke and just
yeah.
like consistently or making consistent jokes or yeah. taking consistent swings mm-hmm. and that person just not getting it.
I feel like some of those people have a disability. Because like I've seen it where like somebody's being funny and this like a guy or a girl simply isn't understanding the cleverness of what they're saying.
Right.
Whether they're puns or like just whatever it is.
Yeah.
I just like, I feel like it's the biggest disability a person can have is no sense of humor.
Yeah.
And that happens more with guys than girls from what I noticed. Because girls will still laugh or they'll have a thought. But there's a lot of guys that will just, they're serious as heck. Mm-hmm. And they have... I don't think they've ever been conditioned to laugh mm-hmm. or even understand. It's weird, but humor is key in every relationship. I Agreed. Can't imagine sticking out with somebody for 40 years where you don't laugh.
Yeah.
That would be a chore.
That would be. You notice that comedians end up, excuse me.
Sure.
Comedians laugh a little bit easier.
Well, comedians are looking to laugh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Have you seen a show on YouTube called The Green Room?
No. I think I've heard the concept.
Okay, so it's a stand-up comedian that I don't even know. Mm-hmm. He hosts the show, and normally we have like four or five comedians in just all sitting in a sofa around like a semicircle.
Yeah,
and then there's an audience around.
Right,
and they just shoot the shit. Mm. But you constantly get new people.
Right.
So so in the same thing, you might get like Aziz Ansari, Bob Saget, and a bunch of other ones that I won't know. Right. Like three or four other ones.
Oh, I haven't seen those. That sounds interesting, though.
And they just talk.
Yeah.
And then they had, you know, what's his name? Moody?
Paul Moody.
Yeah. He had, yeah. Paul Moody was there with a couple other... Jeff Jeffries.
Yep.
Jim and a couple Jeffries. Other... It was really good.
Yep. Jeff Jeffries.
Jim Jeffries, right?
Yeah.
Joe Rogan was there. Nice. Chris Hardwick was there. Mm-hmm. It's really interesting because, like, you know what? It's a more free-form version mm-hmm. and much more funnier, to be honest with you, than... remember when Chris Rock did it with Louie CK... Chris Rock did it with Louis C.K. and some other ones. They were sitting on a sofa and they were talking.
Chris did it with Louis. He did it with Jerry Seinfeld and Ricky Gervais.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, those are heavy hitters. We get it. But like this one is funnier because...
that was also on like HBO or some crap where they had to talk about...
Right.
Yeah.
They're all sitting with their legs crossed going...
Gervais was one asking questions. Right. So it's like it was his production. But like, yeah, I like it when it's just like no topic.
Yeah.
And you're just talking. Especially amongst comics. You hang out pretty late at a comedy store. Mm-hmm. You always find like three, four really good people.
Yeah.
And they'll just be talking and it's a riot. Mm-hmm. Like it's hilarious. Mm-hmm. And it's also, you're looking for it, but these people are so funny.
Yeah.
That, yeah, you put a, you speak into that conversation, you're going to have a good time. Yeah.
So for those people, it's The Green Room on YouTube. All of the episodes are free.
Nice. Just I'll check that out,
watch
man.
Watch it out, yeah.
Comics
watch.
Are my favorite people right now.
Bo Burnham was on it too.
Bo Burnham. How is he as a person?
Interesting as frick.
Yeah.
Dude, I love that guy.
Yeah.
Yeah. They just, you know, they're talking for a bit and they said, hey, there's a piano over there. There's generally a piano.
Yeah.
And he just get them to sing, like sing a song or two and it comes back. But he's like really insightful.
Yeah.
Specifically based on his age. It's really interesting.
He's pretty young, right?
Yeah, he is. But he holds his own with like everyone else there. Mm-hmm. They make fun of him because of his young age.
Yeah.
But you can tell that he's not out of sorts in that setting.
No, probably not, man.
Yeah.
He's been doing this since he was... That's the thing. It's just, it's not your age. It's how many, like anything, like how many reps,
right?
Yeah. If somebody's doing wedding photography since they were 14, mm-hmm. they could be 20 and they could be just as good as somebody who's 30, who's been doing it for, you know, roughly the same amount of time.
So. Right.
Bo Burnham's interesting people.
Yeah, he is. Did you get to watch his thing?
Yeah. We talked about it on the podcast.
Oh, we did. Yeah.
We did
yeah,
like
yeah.
a review thing.
Yeah. Man, I still like that one. Good. I don't think I can watch it again. It's one of those...
it's a one-man show type of thing, but it's heavy too at times.
Exactly. It's a one-time watch for me.
Yeah.
It's like Requiem for a Dream.
Mm, can't watch that shit again.
Holy crap.
Man. I watch every movie at least 3 to 4 times, sometimes 100. I have at least 4 or 5 movies I've seen no less than 50 times. Mm-hmm. But Requiem of a Dream is one movie you watch once. That is a hard pill to swallow. That's a hard dick to take up the butt. You know what I mean? Like, it's just too heavy.
It's rough.
We're still talking about the movie.
That one is one, and an Old Boy, which
I, Old Boy also another one I've seen. I'd watch it again,
yeah,
but I would only maybe watch it one more time.
Yeah, it was that was really good too.
The girl with the dragon tattoo is kind of a, well, you know what? Anything with a rape scene, I don't do too well in.
Yeah, for yeah. good reason.
If there's a, if it's a book like, you know, Kite Runner,
yeah,
I'll find the rapey section and yeah. I'll just be like, just read the end of the paragraph to make sure I'm.
You didn't miss anything critical?
I can't read the whole thing. It's too much for me, man.
It wasn't that long.
I know, but like in some movies, they're pretty... There's yeah, there's a book called A Fine Balance by...
oh my God, it is so brutal. I read that book.
By Rohan Mistry, I believe. Yeah.
That's just sad all over.
Oh, yeah. even now, I'm just like... And reading it, it's like you remember it and it's in your memory now. Yeah.
Like that experience happened, or you spoke to someone.
Yeah, I feel like I've watched it.
Yeah.
I feel like I watched it. I don't like it.
So a few years ago, I had to have a surgery done, and one of our friends, Hannah, she sent me a care package.
Rude! It had that book in it.
No. Okay. No, it was all movies.
Okay.
Right. There's some dark movies in there.
Yeah.
You know, but one of them was a movie called Incendie. Which just means fire in French.
Okay.
S-O-D. And it was rated really well. I think it was nominated for a bunch of awards. So I popped that in and I watched it. Dude, that's Requiem for a Dream in French.
Jeez, no.
And it hits kind of close to home because it's somewhat about like a Muslim family or something. I think it had something to do with Palestine and Israel. Mm-hmm. Maybe not Palestine. Doesn't matter. All I know is that the movie was equal parts great to watch because it was great film.
Yeah.
But at the same time, like, I'm trying to recover here.
I actually like...
What have I done?
I avoid those movies now. Yeah. Like really heavy movies, and I shouldn't. They're works of art, and I should be able to appreciate it. But sometimes I'm like, I don't know, man. Sounds sad, and I feel like such a punk when I do that. But
yeah, but you're gonna carry it around for a couple of days.
I do. Yeah. I feel like it messes with my brain. I feel like I'm less happy as a human for 2 days because I watched a movie that's made up sometimes. And if it's not made up, then I'm even downer in terms of how happy I am.
Yeah. Do you actively avoid your documentaries as well?
Sometimes. I'll watch it if it's neat. Like, I'll watch Palestine-Israel stuff. I'll watch environmental stuff. I'll watch, even though that's extremely depressing.
Oh, my God.
But some things like, you know, acid attacks, you know, was one of the movies Faraz was watching. And I just couldn't. I was like, I don't want to watch this. I am going to be messed up for like, I'm just going to be Sal sleepwalk, you know. I've been sleepwalking a lot lately. I've been keeping up with a lot of news. Just immediate sleepwalking.
Okay, you got to let go of that. A recent documentary that I watched was The 13th.
My sister just recommended that to me while I was speaking with you like a few minutes ago.
It's about the prison industrial complex.
Yeah.
And how since slavery,
right,
the system has been built to keep black people in.
Yeah. 100%.
Yeah.
Through mandatory minimums for nonviolent offenses, through mandatory minimum for like recreational drugs and other parts of the country are, you know, move around fairly easily as long as they're not connected to a certain race.
Right.
Also, Canada does this as well, where in Edmonton, around, I believe, half of the prison population, specifically for women's prisons, is women, Native women. Mm. Because when it comes to bootlegging alcohol or selling cannabis, Native people get disproportionately arrested in Canada compared to the rest of the population here.
Right.
Because nobody seems to care. And it's the same thing in the States where it's like, yeah, you can have a black person in jail if they committed 3 nonviolent offenses in the state of California, because the mandatory minimum in California for nonviolent offenses is, I think, 6 years, or it was last time I checked.
Mm-hmm.
For nonviolent offenses, 6 years.
Yeah.
That's ridiculous.
It is.
Because people are making money off of it.
Yeah. And the thing is that it's not like long time ago, I used to be like, really? There's there's a pointed conspiracy by a group of people who are trying to get black people to go in prison. Like that's the way how I was trying to make sense of it. But it's not that. It's like this huge organism that was already moving in a particular fashion.
Yeah.
So when it decides to move a little bit one way or the other,
yeah,
it has to self-correct.
Right.
And it just does it for the best interest. So what was interesting was, and I'm going to butcher this, but whatever. When slavery was abolished, mm-hmm. what ended up happening was, you know, the 13th Amendment. So like there is no slavery except for if you're in prison, mm-hmm. then you can be a slave.
Yep.
Right. And so during that time, what they had done is that they were just arresting black people mm-hmm. for the smallest of crimes
right.
because they had an entire workforce that, like nothing is working anymore. Like who's going to pick all the cotton?
Right.
So you could just got to like make them prisoners.
And that was the economic engine for the US for such a long time yeah. was free labor and a lot of agriculture, tobacco, yeah. cotton, other things. Yeah. And all of a sudden they're like, oh, we can't have free labor anymore. What do we do?
Yeah.
Well, let's make a system. And the system works so well that it's still around to this date.
Yeah. So every time they're trying to get freer, mm-hmm. the big organism just kind of like, I see where you're trying to go over here, and then
it's
just redirects
crazy,
you.
Man.
Yeah.
I would definitely say that when it comes to racial issues, especially in the South, uh-huh. man, it hasn't gotten a lot better.
Right.
And that's why I like Canada, because it's not the South, and I'm not black.
Yeah, that's true. No. And we're not Aborigines either.
Dude.
Because they have a hard time in Canada.
Yeah, man. We're actually really lucky. I know we're Muslim. I get some bad things, but like mm-hmm. overall, we have a lot of good people think I'm good at math for no reason, you know?
You're counting?
Things. Yeah.
Really?
Maybe.
Are you good at accounting?
A little bit.
Yeah. All of our friends are accountants, man.
Yeah. That's what we have to do. Mm-hmm. Parents made us.
That is true. That is weird how like brown people kind of fit in like this little groove.
It's because our parents only, they're like, hey, what does this guy need to have to get himself married? Doctor, lawyer, engineer, accountant. And the accountant is when you have a dumb kid, you're like, shit, he's going to have to be an accountant. And after that is just disappointment if you go any below that. So.
Right. Well, I'm glad I made engineer.
Yep. See, that's how that works.
Yeah. How do they feel about sales? You're all about the sales.
Yeah, because I don't care what people, I mean, my parents would prefer if I was a doctor, of course. My mom told me that.
Right.
When she realized I was dumb. She's like, I want you to be a doctor. I'm not going to be as happy if you're not a doctor. But then she realized that, oh, he's not going to be a doctor. So and she was like, all right, well, just go to school and see what kind of sticks. So, okay. Alhamdulillah. Now she's happy that once you realize that, oh, you can make money in other ways.
Right.
Your parents
right.
just want you to be happy.
That's true.
But when you're young and stupid, they're just like, please just be a doctor. We immigrated here because of you. I'm not trying to put pressure on you, but like, why else did we come? And then you're at school, like, I came to this country to be a doctor.
I tried it too.
Yeah.
I learned that cows have four stomachs.
In biology. You went veterinarian.
No, I went biology, and that's what we were learning.
Oh, okay.
We were learning at the time.
Okay.
I couldn't do it.
No.
Couldn't do it. Then again, I couldn't do math really that well either. I don't even know why I went and became an engineer. I know, Lego. But
Legos made you an engineer.
Pretty much.
Well, mashallah, man.
I love cars.
Could have been a lot of things. If you had different toys as a kid, you might have been a whole different person. Some, you know, got a Barbie doll house and you're like, hey, I'm an architect. Or something else. I don't know. Like, a lot of things could have gone a lot of ways.
All right, man, let's wrap this up. Are you ready to go?
Yeah, I'm ready to go.
It's time to go home. All right, people, thank you for listening to the podcast. Thank you for tuning in. We'll be back in a week. Take care.
Love yourself.